I wanted to welcome everybody for coming here. This is absolutely amazing for having as many people as we have right now. My name is Suyapa Miranda. I'm the Executive Director of St. Anthony Park Community Council. And here are our candidates, Russ Stark, as you can see, and Tom Goldstein. I also want to thank the League of Women Voters for hosting this amazing event right now. So thank you. And Sigrid, come on. There you go. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. I also would like to welcome the candidates and the audience to tonight's Ward 4 City Council Candidate Forum. My name is Sigrid Johnson, and I am a board member of the League of Women Voters of St. Paul. But I'm not a constituent in Ward 4. I live in Ward 7. Co-sponsors tonight are the St. Anthony Park Community Council and the St. Anthony Park Branch Library. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan, volunteer political organization that encourages informed and active participation of all citizens in government and influences policy through education and advocacy. The League of Women Voters and the partners made this event possible tonight do not endorse or oppose any political party or candidate. The purpose of the meeting is to hear each candidate's views on a variety of topics, and any views expressed by any of the candidates tonight are theirs alone and do not necessarily reflect views of the sponsoring organizations. A little background on this position for City Council. Council members must live in the ward they represent and are elected to 4-year terms. The current term runs through the end of 2015. As the legislative body, the City Council sets city policy through ordinances and resolutions. The council has sole responsibility for adopting the city budget and performs a quasi-judicial role in hearing appeals. For example, if a property owner wants to appeal a decision of the zoning board. The city council also serves as the library board, which oversees the St. Paul library system and also the Housing and Redevelopment Authority, HRA, is another responsibility, which supports housing and commercial development through loans and bond issuance. Council members also serve on other boards and commissions, such as the St. Paul Port Authority and the Water Commission. The council legislates by passing ordinances, which become city laws. The council also makes performance auditing decisions and monitors the operation and performance of city agencies and holds regular oversight hearings on city departments to determine how programs are working and whether budgeted funds are being spent well. In its decision-making roles, the City Council actively involves the public through its weekly public meeting. And I think it's on Wednesday in the late afternoons. Before we formally begin tonight, would you please turn off all cell phones to silent? Videotaping this evening is by SPNN TV cable channel 19. And broadcast times may be found on its website, www.spnn.org. To begin, each candidate will be given up to 2 minutes for an opening statement. The order of speaking had been determined by a drawing. And after the first round, questions will be answered in a rotation format, and each candidate will be given equal time to respond. Following the opening statement, candidates will respond to written questions from you, the audience. Question cards will be collected from the audience, and no questions of a personal nature will be permitted. Candidates will have 2 minutes to respond to questions, and the order to which they respond will rotate throughout the evening. Then each candidate will be given 2 minutes for a closing statement. A rebuttal, if there any is needed, would be 1 minute. No campaign signs or literature are permitted in this room, and signs or literature may be placed outside of the hall. They may be brought in after the meeting is over. Persons wearing t-shirts and slogans or political logos will be asked not to wear them inside the forum room. A timekeeper will time the statements, and would you just hold up your, they're sitting in the front here. The timekeeper will give you two prompts. The first when you have 30 seconds left, the second and last is when you must stop speaking. A notepad and pencil is provided for each candidate, and candidates are allowed to have notes, but use of electronic devices is not allowed. The sponsor and moderator reserve the right to ask disruptive audience members to leave. Please hold your applause until the end of the forum. Question cards used in the forum become the property of the League of Women Voters and the forum sponsors. Okay, now we'll get started. And the first candidate to speak with opening statement is Russ Stark.
Well, thank you, and good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here tonight, and I wanted to thank the League of Women Voters and St. Anthony Park Community Council for co-hosting. I'm Russ Stark. I've been your council member for the last 8 years or so. I ran 8 years ago on a campaign all about creating a more sustainable and livable city, and I think we've made a lot of progress toward that end in that period. The Green Line is the most obvious incarnation of that. I just saw the numbers are out today that 45,000 riders a day were riding the train in September, which is well beyond the 2030 projections for what was expected. I really want to continue to focus on issues of sustainability, including transportation, energy, and solid waste in a third term. I think we are doing pretty well in St. Paul, but there's a lot of work still to do. In some ways, we have an exciting time in the city in that we are growing in population and jobs for the first time in a long time. We believe we've exceeded 300,000 people, according to the most recent surveys, for the first time in decades. And I think the flip side of that is that in spite of our growth and success, not everyone is experiencing that growth and success equally, and we have a lot of work to do to make sure that more of our lower income residents and our residents of color enjoy the benefits of growth and success that many parts of the city are starting to see. There are a number of ways we can do that, and I'm sure we'll get into those later in the evening. I've lived in Hamlin Midway for the last 16 years. I live a couple blocks from University Avenue, and it's been a great community to be a part of. One of the interesting things about Ward 4 is the diversity of the neighborhoods and how different they are, but also how much a part they are of the great city of St. Paul. Just briefly wanted to mention that a big initiative last year was actually to restore evening library hours at some of the branches, including this one. And I just got my cue to stop, so I will.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Tom Goldstein.
Hi, thanks everyone for coming as well. I think there are vast differences in the way that Russ and I approach this race and look at the state of the city. I think sustainability is important. I think the issues he talked about are important, But I'm more interested in the fact that we have 24% of our population living in poverty, including 25,000 children, that we have a city that is working great for those, for the wealthy developers, for sports team owners, for people who are connected to the city, but not so great for the rest of us. Russ recently supported a parkland dedication ordinance that would reduce the amount of parkland that developers would have to provide to nearly zero, which to me, especially for a community like St. Anthony Park that values its green space, and as seeing some of that challenged with the Luther Seminary redevelopment, I think that's a pretty vital part of communities, is that we preserve as much green space as possible. I've worked on broadband as something that is very vital to the community, and have gotten nowhere with the city council. It doesn't think that broadband access is important enough that it should be an initiative of the city. Ironically, we've created a task force now, in the process of creating a task force, to look at a soccer stadium, but we haven't been willing to create a task force to look at broadband, which is a utility that will benefit many, many more people than a soccer stadium, but it's a question of priorities. What I do want to work on is creating jobs, which is the quickest way out of poverty. I want to look at extending a livable wage to all people in St. Paul, that we have a transparent government, that we have clear goals that we can all follow. And we'll talk about that the rest of the night, including what I call my alternative state of the city, which is a lot of facts that will, unfortunately, are inconvenient truths that we need to come to grips with as a community if we're really being honest about how we're doing as a city.
Okay, thank you. We'll start with Mr. Goldstein for the first question.
I'll take astronomy for 500, I'm sorry.
Are you ready?
I am ready.
Tell us what TIF is, T-I-F. How okay. Stadiums got by with never paying property taxes.
Is that a two-part question then?
Well, stadiums with TIF.
Well, TIF, I think it's pretty tough to give a TIF explanation in 2 minutes, but I'll try. TIF stands for Tax Increment Financing. It's in theory a tool used to address blighted property. You have a property that's sitting there that's not is a blight on the community, and no one wants to improve it or rebuild it or whatever. So developer will come in and say, okay, I'll agree to improve this property and build it up to such a value. If you'll forgive the taxes that I pay on the increment or the difference. So if a property's worth $1 million and a developer comes in and says, hey, I'll redevelop that property, it'll be worth $10 million. The $9 million would be the increment, and then the property tax that would be owed on that $9 million would essentially not be collected it would not come to the city's general fund. Instead, the money would be used to, the city could take out a loan, give the loan to the developer, and the developer could then use the property taxes he or she would ordinarily pay to the city to pay off the bonds on that loan. That's not precisely it, but that's as close as I can give for a quick explanation. Unfortunately, it's been dramatically abused in St. Paul. By my calculations, and it's hard to make sure they're accurate because the city doesn't do a particularly good job in putting the figures out there, something I will change if elected. About $25 million a year goes towards paying off TIF projects, doesn't come to the general fund. We have buildings going back as far as Lawson Software, which goes back to Norm Coleman's administration, that the city long ago sold. We still owe $25 million that we're paying on that, and those payments cannot go to the rest of the city. I'll have to get to the ballpark issue later, but we'll have plenty of time for that.
Okay. We've had a request asking the candidates to stand because people in the back would like to see you when you're speaking. So, Mr. Stark. Up and down.
Okay, so we got 2 minutes on the same question.
Yes.
So, okay. Yes. Tom got it mostly right. The tax increment financing is a tool for redevelopment, mostly used in urban areas, which it's always more expensive to develop in urban areas because of things like underground pollution and other things that make it complicated to do development in the city compared to a greenfield. The thing that the tax increment has to be used for under state law is some aspect of the development that provides public benefit, and that's the part that he missed. So typically that's public infrastructure, be it streets or stormwater management or parking or those kinds of things. TIF can also be used as a way to underwrite the affordable component of a housing development, so to create affordable units in a development that might not otherwise have them. But state law restricts our ability to use TIF on certain things. We have a policy in St. Paul that no more than 10% of our tax base can be in TIF districts. We've kept to that policy. We actually bumped up to it pretty close in the last few years, but we have a couple of districts coming off of the rolls in the next couple of years. And so it's been a process of managing and making sure that we're using it responsibly. I'm not going to say that it's always been used responsibly. I think a lot of the projects that were done, particularly in the 80s and 90s, when the city was particularly desperate for some development, didn't pan out very well. The districts that I'm aware of that have been created over the last 10 years are performing very well. Some of them are actually being paid off faster than anticipated. The other thing about TIF is that it has to meet the but-for test. In other words, but for the tax increment being invested up front, the project would not happen. So many times we're faced with the choice of, do we see no development at all, or do we use this tool to spur development? And I agree with Tom, there have been times when it's been used incorrectly. I think we will get to the stadium issue later.
Stay standing, because you're the first person on the next question. Yes.
So
one minute rebuttal.
Do people need me to stand?
Yeah.
Okay. He's a little taller than I am. So this is going to be the first of several disagreements. I think TIF has been terribly abused in St. Paul. I think there's no question about that. I think some very clear examples are the Penfield project had TIF funding that is a luxury condo project on the edge of downtown with a Lund store, pool, jacuzzi, all sorts of things in it. I don't think that's the purpose of the funding, but more recently, there's $11 million in TIF that's been approved for the Macy's building, which is not blighted, it's just empty. And so we're gonna put a practice arena for the Wild in there. That's how we're using our TIF funding. On top of it, the city has already passed a resolution requesting TIF funding for the Ford site. The Ford site is vacant. It's probably the most desirable state in the entire, the most desirable site in the entire state. So we have abused TIF. There are many districts that have not ended, only a few have ended, and I think that is one of the sources of a lot of our financial woes is the way we are abusing TIF in St. Paul.
Thank you. Are you?
The last speaker gets a rebuttal. It's not a dual rebuttal. We discussed that beforehand, sorry.
Okay, are you ready for the next question? Question number two deals with district councils. What role should district councils play in city decision-making process, especially with respect to city policy? We have two questions about the same topic.
Okay. I'm going to start out with 15 seconds back on TIF. I voted against the Penfield. There is no approved deal for Macy's, and I oppose any TIF on Macy's if it's used for retail, which is the proposal right now, so Tom and I agree there. On the Ford site, it would be needed for things like street infrastructure. We just don't have other funding sources for building new streets in St. Paul. District councils are now 40 years old in the city of St. Paul. We just had a celebration acknowledging the 40-year history a week and a half ago down at City Council. And they were created to be a citizen participation model that at the time was unique in the country, trying to make sure that citizens had an outlet to participate more in the decisions that the city was making. They play an advisory role and oftentimes will review an issue such as a land use issue or transportation issue or whatever the issue may be, and provide a recommendation either to the Planning Commission, in some cases to the City Council. And it's been, I think, one of the things that has created a really strong set of neighborhoods in St. Paul in that 40-year history with a lot of cohesion. A lot of opportunity for people to feel like they are, in fact, a part of their community and have a real voice in the decisions that the city is making. I think it's time for us to think about ways to reinvigorate the system. The city itself also needs to think about new and better ways to engage our community outside of the district council system. People are wanting to engage differently today than they did 40 years ago. It's actually fairly unusual to get a room full of people like this these days for community meetings. People are more wanting to quickly provide input on their mobile device or at home, and we're starting to move in that direction in the city. I think we have to do more of that, and then decide how the district council system fits into our new models of community engagement.
Tom Goldstein.
So, no disagreement on the value of district councils. I've served on two myself, originally the Mack Groveland Community Council back in the late 1980s, and then I'm on the Hamlin Midway. I serve on the Development Committee, so technically I'm not on the board of the council, but I've been involved with it. Their independence is, to me, what's really important. Unfortunately, during Norm Coleman's administration, he sought to destroy that independence by undoing the funding. I think one thing the city needs to do is to provide more funding for district councils so that they're all on a level playing field. Some, and depending on the neighborhoods that they are located, have much better access to funding, have much better resources. So we're creating kind of unequal structures, which just further exacerbates the inequality that we have in the city. Neighborhoods that are doing very well, that have a lot of resources, neighborhoods that are really stressed that we're not. I think they're also very key to transparency, because this is government from the bottom up rather than the top down. Unfortunately, not enough ideas start at the district council level and come to the city. It is more the city puts out ideas and pushes them down to the district councils and asks them to comment and give their suggestions when the agenda has already been determined. And I think that's actually very harmful to the city, and I would like there to be more independence. And although they are advisory bodies, that we actually listen to them and fund them properly so that they can be independent and representative of neighbors. I think the lack of participation just reflects that the city is not becoming more transparent, it's becoming less transparent. The recent decision to eliminate emails after 6 months is one example. The proposed agreement to try to have sort of a secretive agreement around the soccer stadium that was only backed down after a few days when there was a pretty large protest. I think there's too much keeping information from the public. And so revising district councils would be one way to at least help reverse that trend that's happening at City Hall. Thank you.
No, stay standing. You're the first person on the... No. Okay.
Stay standing.
Ready? This one is on the topic of police brutality. How are you going to address police brutality in St. Paul? What steps would you take? Whose fault is it, and how will you determine that?
Well, I think that's a fairly complex topic, but I'm going to be very straightforward about my response. I think the first thing is that we need to have cameras. Police officers need to be equipped cameras so that there is no confusion about what's happening. Yes, there are some privacy issues, but I think we can address them. But I think all police should have cameras so that the really tragic things we're hearing about that happen to show up because someone has a cell phone, that we minimize the chance of that happening. I think the biggest problem with police brutality has to do with hiring practices and lack of accountability. On this sheet that I call the alternative state of the city that many of you have, there are a number of claims the city has paid out for police brutality. So obviously it's a problem. Even if we may have a good police force, it's not a good enough police force that we don't have some severe problems that are leading to significant payouts in brutality claims. I also think that we need to have accountability. What really, as a police force, what are the accountability measures that we have? I have talked with commanders, and I've never heard any specific thing other than they kind of monitor crime and monitor number of police calls. But there's no thing that says, for example, we want to reduce all excessive force complaints by 50% in 2 years, or we want to make sure that there are zero shootings, that our goal is zero shootings. Of course that's their goal, but as a tangible thing, here's how we will try to arrive at that, rather than saying, you know, in the end, some people are going to get shot, it's sad, but that's part of a community. So to really focus on how we can reduce violence, because police officers are often the, you know, to be very honest, they do lots of great work. I know a lot of great cops in St. Paul, but I also read stories where police have not handled things well, and those need to be learning experiences that should be the basis for forums and training and ongoing development that I don't think is happening, and that's what needs to change. We need to actually have ongoing professional development on equity and all sorts of other issues that are the subject of brutality complaints.
Mr. Stark.
Yeah, I think Tom and I largely agree on this topic. A couple of things that are important to know. One is that the police department has been undergoing de-escalation training for all police officers, which I think is a key part of what's missing. Frankly, what I've seen in my years is that too often there will be an incident, in some cases there is video, in some cases there isn't, where all of us, frankly, question the behavior of the officers. Sometimes you can't know what was going on because you don't see what happened before. But too often, the officers, in what seemed to be a situation where they have done something incorrectly, in some cases unethical, there's very few consequences because there's an ability to fall back on, this is what I was trained to do. And so I think we have to go take a step back and say, what are the actual techniques in the training to prevent the escalation in the first place? And I know that Chief Smith is doing a lot in that area, and I applaud him for it. I think we've got to do more. I think as a city, we are lucky in that we have a department that is really focused on these issues. I think the recent protests involving Black Lives Matter have been a great example of our police department's ability to manage a group that wants to be able to have their voice heard without having situations flare up that might in other cities. We do have a review committee called the Police Civilian Internal Affairs Review Commission, and the mayor's office actually recently asked for an outside audit of what that commission does and how they function. It was created about 30 years ago and was groundbreaking. The review is looking at the structure and whether or not it still makes sense. There are a couple of police officers who serve as part of that group, and one of the questions being raised is, should police officers be part of this review commission?
Thank you. Rebuttal? Okay. There's a question here on veterans' employment. What programs, if any, do you see being implemented for vets? And let's see, Mr. Stark, you start that one?
Absolutely. At this point in time, I don't believe the city has any specific programs targeting veterans. However, federal law does require that there's veterans preference in our hiring at the city, and that applies to private employers as well. So there are a lot of new things in place that will make it easier for vets to get jobs. One of the related areas, of course, is veteran homelessness. And there's been a real focus on that both federally and in Minnesota in recent years, to the point where we've actually made a lot of progress in the state. And I've heard some people in the field say that we may not have homeless vets a couple of years from now in the state of Minnesota, which would be quite an accomplishment. In the area of jobs, I think it's tough. You got folks coming back from deployment overseas. In some cases, their skills don't match the jobs that are out there. And certainly continuing to bolster the programs that we have in St. Paul College and elsewhere of job training and retraining are an important component of that. Today, the city doesn't have specific programs targeting employment for vets.
Well, I'm going to have to take Russ's word on what city veteran services, what the city may have in terms of veteran services, because I'm not familiar with what the city may have. I can say that in a broader sense, and I'm not sure if that question has to do with veterans who are homeless, veterans who, you know, were trying to find paths back to employment, who've been experiencing long-term homelessness, or whether we're referring to veterans who have just returned in the last 10 years. Obviously, it's a huge challenge, and it certainly goes well beyond a municipal challenge. It is a federal challenge. It's a challenge for all of us, because many veterans are coming back suffering from PTSD. They've had horrendous injuries, traumatic brain injuries, the whole gamut. And so even if they have the skills, the fact that they have these injuries are probably very often going to keep them from going back to jobs that we had. So I think the first thing we have to do is be compassionate. We have to be empathetic and understand there are many people in our midst who we need to serve that don't have the same sort of advantages that we do as a result of their experience. And I think it just goes to jobs in general. As a city, unfortunately, we do not have a comprehensive plan in which to create jobs. The jobs that we seem to create are just construction projects. That's the main thing we do. We're still lagging behind from the Great Recession. According to 2 years ago, NPR has talked about this. St. Paul was lagging behind 5,000 jobs in the recovery. Minneapolis had completely recovered. And so it's the fact that we don't have jobs for people in general, and young people, and people in poverty, let alone for veterans, that I think exacerbates our ability to deal effectively with veterans. So there's a lot that we have to do, not just to serve veterans, but to serve anyone else, and use relationships with the state and federal level to promote whatever we can in the way of job training, retraining, and et cetera. Thanks.
Okay. Next question, Mr. Goldstein. Name one city, St. Paul, sponsored initiative that you would like to support assuming office.
Current initiative?
Initiative, well, is all it says.
I mean, I'm not sure which one I'd like to support. I'd like to make a lot of them better. I guess all I can do is talk about what I want to see happen as a city, and hopefully that will get at the questioner's what the questioner is asking. What I want to see us do is extend the livable wage ordinance, so I guess you could say that is something we have. It just applies to businesses who are doing business with the city or contracting with the city. I'd like to see that extended to all large employers, so exemption for small employers and startups. I'd like us to leverage city resources, the existing resources we have, to better serve education, so that we are making sure that every school in St. Paul has a business partner. I know that Murray has supposed to have a partnership with H.B. Fuller. 3M has a partnership with Dayton's Bluff, but there are not enough consistent partnerships with businesses and organizations and faith community with schools. And I think that's a way for adults to come in and mentor and provide a path for kids to see what the world is like, and also a chance for kids to come out to those business or organizations and see what real world is, which may help them with some inspiration that they may not be getting at home, particularly if their kids living in poverty or kids are coming from one or no parent families and being raised by a grandparent who's so busy just trying to keep their head above water that they can't mentor the way that two parent families can. And I also think that we need to use our tax policies wiser so that we're not unduly burdening small businesses or homeowners. But I'm sure Russ can speak better with programs that he believes are doing very well. One of the reasons I'm running is because I don't think enough of our programs are doing as well as they should.
Okay. I do want to speak about some existing programs, but ones that I think we have to expand upon. I mentioned that I think the biggest challenge in the city right now is extending the benefits of our growth and success in some pockets to the rest of our community. I think the first thing that the city can do in that area is to think of ourselves first as the large employer that we are. If you count the water department, we've got nearly 3,200 employees at the city of St. Paul. And we have to create more ladders of opportunity to good-paying jobs within the city for our residents of color and low incomes. Today, only 20% of city employees are people of color, and the city's adult population is 40% people of color. So we've got a lot of work to do in that area. We've seen some progress, particularly in the fire department in recent years, with the creation of what's called the EMS Academy, which is essentially breaking down some of those barriers to entry by training kids to get their EMT certification for free and actually providing them a stipend while they're doing it. And then they can get a job as a fire safety cadet, transporting people from the hospital who are leaving the hospital. And while they're doing that, can go back to school, get their firefighter training, and eventually get into the department. We've got to look department by department, and this is what we're doing, to try and create those ladders of opportunity to make sure that we are not just doing better job of recruiting, but actually specifically targeting our young adults of color and low income to try and get them into these city jobs. The other program that I'm excited about that's growing used to be just called our Summer Youth Job Corps program, or Summer Youth Job Program. It's now called Right Track, and it's a program of internships that we do both as a city, but also a lot of our private employers in the city have joined that program, and they're taking on high school kids, mostly kids of color, for internships in the summer that in many cases are then leading to another internship and in some cases a good paying job later.
Okay. 1 minute.
So I think it's great that we have all those programs. We need more city employees like inspectors to make sure that we enforce the code so that we don't have landlords who are irresponsible and promoting student housing and other things where they're making a lot of money and not keeping up their properties. And we often hear we don't have the money to create these jobs because we have a revenue shortage, so we need to look at parking meters and things like that. We can talk all about all these things we need to do. The concern is that we haven't done that. We are so focused on benefiting the few instead of the many because of all these development deals, all these giveaways, the pursuit of stadiums, the kinds of things that eat up the resources so that we can't have all these robust programs that I could talk with you at length about how wonderful they were, because a lot of our programs are not wonderful because we're not supporting them properly because we're misspending the resources we have. So I'm sorry to sort of burst a bubble there, but I think they're good people, but they're not being well led, and we need to do a better job of serving everyone and not just a few special interests.
Okay.
My next is?
No. Start. And this question is particularly directed to Mr. Stark. It's regarding the Marshall Avenue restoration. 1,500 to 2,000 people signed a petition against the third phase of the Marshall Avenue Green Street proposal. You say you are a good listener. Who did you listen to when you decided to amend, not end, the phase three?
Okay. Hey, Terry. Thanks for the question. for those of you who haven't heard of it, Marshall Avenue Green Streets was a community-led initiative by a lot of the neighbors along Marshall Avenue in Merriam Park, now considered part of Union Park, that started probably 10, 12 years ago. And the idea was to try and make Marshall a more pedestrian and bicycle-friendly street. The part of that was to try and install some of those planted medians that we have today on Marshall as a way of both beautifying the street, calming traffic, adding the bike lanes, and then creating safer crossings at the intersections where many people cross. The project wasn't ever fully completed. My predecessor actually voted to finance the first piece of it. I came into office, and the last piece that's being referred to here was a short section of median at the corner of Marshall and Wilder, right by Izzy's and Copland's Coffee and those businesses right near Cleveland. And we prioritized that intersection for another median segment because so many people cross the street there at Wilder trying to get back and forth to those businesses. And so while there certainly was opposition in the community to having another median there, there was also quite a bit of support. And to me, it boiled down to safety and trying to make a safe crossing for people trying to get to those businesses at Cleveland and Marshall.
So I was not aware that this issue was as hot a topic as it was many years after the fact, until I was out door knocking in the community and found so many people that, even though the median had already talked about being planned, were still opposed to it. And I thought, oh, boy, I sure got this wrong. I thought everybody was happy with it. And you know, there was a public process, and there was a public process for many years. But there's a way you can conduct a public process in which it's pretty clear what direction it's going, and the people that are supporting it could be very loud and making it clear that others that don't agree are not welcome, and that after a while you stop showing up, so pretty much the public process seems to be 80, 90, 100% of the people there support it. I think that seems to be part of the element that happened there. It seems to be just the opposite with Grand Avenue Meters, where everybody's against it and the city council and the mayor are for it. But I think that what I see now is we have a median that doesn't do what was supposed to be done. If traffic calming, and I think having safe crossings is important, so you stripe it and you put in flashing lights that people can activate and you see if that helps with the problem. If that doesn't work, then you can look at median or what I would call more extensive efforts. But to just put in a median and then end up creating an opening so people can turn into the liquor store, which is what the people who originally pushed the median wanted not to happen. There's nobody that's happy with this issue. I have people that support it and are against it that are supporting me because there's so much dissatisfaction. And I think it's a signal that this was not handled well and you should be revisited. Instead, Russ took funding from CIB and rolled it out with very little notice to the neighborhood and said, we're gonna put in this median, which is really just a quasi-median, and closes off a turn onto Wilder and leaves an opening to turn the liquor store. And if I had a rebuttal, I could go into more about why I think that's a really bad way to do it, but how there would have been a better way to do it that I think would have made more people happier.
1 minute.
Yeah, thank you. One of the lessons of this project for me is that people feel really strongly about what we do with our streets. It's actually pretty remarkable. The level of interest and concern. And I think part of that comes from this, the fact that, honestly, in our office, the most common complaint that we get is a concern about traffic safety and people feeling unsafe crossing streets and that traffic is moving too fast. So that was my primary motivation in supporting the project, was to get at that issue, and not just by trying something that may or may not work, by actually doing the thing that our professional traffic engineers say will make people safer and will reduce crashes. And that's exactly what I supported.
Okay, Mr. Goldstein, you'll be the next for this. And there's two similar questions on internet and broadband. As a university student, I rely on internet access every day. What would you do to ensure everyone in St. Paul has equal access to quality high-speed internet? The other question is, how do we create competitive options for residential broadband?
Well, I really appreciate that question, particularly because it feels like this is actually something that's a little more related to St. Anthony Park. Not many of the other questions have been. And so I hope we have some more questions related to this community where we're hosting this event. Folks may be familiar with Connect St. Paul, which is a campaign that I co-founded with a graduate student to address this exact issue. I actually spent 2 years working on this issue, and it's one of the reasons why I'm running for city council, because we followed all the steps. We went around, we talked to people in the community. I talked to all the city council members, talked to all the county commissioners. They said they were in favor of better broadband access. But then both entities signed deals with Comcast to manage their own networks, including the city, which did a $4 million deal, $400,000 a year to pay Comcast to run the city's network as part of a no-bid contract. That is simply horrible city policy. It just should never have happened that way. So we don't have a solution, but even though we went to the DFL convention, we got a resolution passed. It passed with the highest amount of votes, so it became part of the DFL platform. Even now, the city has no policy to address broadband concerns. Our policy is Comcast, and now I'm sure will tell you that we're going to ink a deal with CenturyLink, as if having a duopoly is going to change anything. Cities like Chattanooga have invested in broadband. They have fiber for everyone. These are the kind of projects we should be pursuing. Given that the school district is giving every kid an iPad, whether that's a good idea or not, as many as a third of kids go home without internet service. We have no plan to address it. And there are things that we can do that don't cost money that the city could be doing right now with every construction project. And I will talk about them on my rebuttal. Thank you.
Mr. Stark.
Yeah, thanks for the question. Just when I started on the city council, I received a report of the work that had been done on this topic by the commission or committee that had been set up by one of my early colleagues, Lee Helgen, on this issue that looked at what the options were in St. Paul to improve broadband access. At the time, you may recall, Minneapolis was looking at this idea that they eventually implemented of Wi-Fi. And the report said that the public Wi-Fi systems at the time were not that reliable. The service wasn't very high quality and recommended against pursuing that option. The option that it did propose that we take a look at was essentially fiber to the premises, meaning building a fiber network across the city that would get to every building and every household. The price tag that was put on that concept at that time, unfortunately, was on around $325 million across the city. Because of increased construction costs since then, and they have gone up dramatically, people are estimating that the current dollars, it would be a $500 million project. That does not mean that it's outside of the realm of possibility. It does mean that that's about the equivalent of our annual city budget. I do think that making sure that we have good options is important. I think that we have to define what the problem is first. And if the problem is low-income folks not having access to broadband, we are working on that issue by providing higher speed service in our libraries and rec centers, by providing the ability for people to actually rent the internet at our libraries. It's actually a hotspot device that people can take out and bring home. Those aren't perfect solutions, but they are a step in the right direction. Tom has asked that we reestablish the commission. There's nothing wrong with the idea of reestablishing the commission. I haven't heard an idea yet that would be the thing that we would do that would make an impact on this issue.
So this is to me a very clear distinction between having a vision for the city and not having a vision. Because this broadband, the world is moving online, whether we like it or not. Education is online, distance learning is online, jobs are online, job applications. Everyone benefits from it. I didn't create it, but it's out of the bag, and countries, Europe is way, way ahead of us. St. Paul is not going to be competitive if it doesn't do something about it. These other approaches are really band-aids. And it's the fact, well, if we want to talk about money, here's three projects that cost $150 million. The Saints Ballpark, the Penn Field, and the Palace Theater. That's just three. I'll bet you if we really scrutinize, I could find projects in the last couple years that cost $500 million. So the idea that it's about money, it's not about money, it's about priorities. You're not talking about spending the money overnight. And $500 million is a figure Russ is just throwing out there. Construction costs are very high because the money's being spent on stadiums and labor is scarce and it's forced up the cost of all projects. That's a true story.
Am I next?
No, Mr. Stark starts the next question. And this is about equity and gaps. We hear a lot about gaps, achievement gap, homeownership gap, and income gaps between white household and households of color. What specific things can the city do to shrink these gaps?
I already talked about the what we need to do and are doing in terms of creating ladders of opportunity to city jobs and the internship program. I think that's an important component. I think probably the next biggest piece would be continuing to strengthen our relationship with the school district and our institutions of higher learning, including community colleges like St. Paul College. I give the mayor a lot of credit in having created this program called Sprockets that has unified all of the out-of-school and after-school programs across St. Paul, where you can find all those programs in one spot online, and coordinated information between the school district, the county, and the city in terms of which kids are actually needing those services and how they can get them. I think the biggest challenge that we have, honestly, that is unmet in terms of reducing disparities is in early childhood. And we have been part of programs where we've gotten federal and state grants to do some to do scholarships for quality early childhood education and preschool in neighborhoods like Frogtown and Summit University. But those have been relatively short-term grant-based programs. They are extremely expensive programs. Childcare is expensive. And so ultimately, I think the solutions to that part of the issue are federal and state funding that will go from universal pre-K to actually beginning to fund universal child care at earlier and earlier ages. I think that's the thing that we can actually do as a society to make the most difference. That's not something St. Paul can do, but we can certainly use our voices to make the case that we need to be investing more in our youngest kids.
Gaps.
So I think there's a major gap with the city acknowledging that this is a problem. We talk about it, and we talk about it, and we talk about it, and the solution is the federal or state or beyond our means. When are we going to actually get at solving the problem? Every iteration of the mayor's strategic plan, the word poverty is not mentioned once. I get Russ's emails, for he sends out a list periodically of a newsletter from his office. I think I'm almost never seen the word poverty mentioned there. Russ is talking about equity now. He's been talking about equity recently in mailings that have been going out. But from the start, he came in talking about transportation and sustainability. Poverty was never part of that message. Until we acknowledge that we have a problem, until we acknowledge that it is completely unacceptable to have 67,000 people living below the poverty line and 25,000 children, all this talk about what we should do, yes, we should do all those things. We should have universal child care and early learning and sprockets and all these programs. But until you actually start focusing on, when you have solving poverty and closing education as a citywide commitment, then you're going to solve it. When your focus is clearly on development and stadiums and everything that the chamber talks about, everything that's in the news is about another project downtown. It just keeps about building buildings. That is our focus as a city, to just keep building things, not actually invest in people. And that's why I have a campaign that talks about people before politics and is neighborhood focused, because as a city, we are not doing that. And it's just, it becomes talk. It's good sounding talk. It sounds great for sound bites, but actually caring and knowing the people in poverty and working on programs that will help them, that's not happening enough, and we need to stop talking about it and actually start acting on it. And hopefully I'll have another segment where I can talk more about what that acting would look like.
Okay. 1 minute.
We are acting, and I just wanted to mention a couple of areas in which we are that I didn't before. One is that I actually co-chaired a group called the Big Picture Project that created a really bold goal for affordable housing along the Green Line. Many folks have been assuming that the Green Line will, over time, increase the value of land and rents along that corridor. And so we created a goal of establishing a lot of affordable housing now before those rents went up, so that we would sort of lock in some affordability in our community along that corridor, where we hope to also be growing many jobs and have started to do that. Also, in terms of specifically focusing on poverty, I can tell you on my desk at the office, and Tom hasn't been there, so he hasn't seen it, but in my desk there's like a glass covering, and the single piece of paper I have under the glass on my desk is a Wilder report, one-page report on the status of poverty in St. Paul. I think about it every day.
Okay. Let's see, Mr. Goldstein, you go first on this one. What are the plans for development on Energy Park Avenue where the Midway Stadium was, what would you like to happen, and what can the city do to help you, your vision?
Not focus on building a stadium there. What I think, because this site has been neglected for 20 years, is why we are faced with something that looks like blighted property. It should, if we had put the same energy then we put into a lot of other glitzier projects into that, I think we'd be well on our way to a solution. There is a plan. The city has a plan to redevelop. They don't own the parcel, but there was a significant plan that was put together that was a group from Denver came out and brought it forward. It's more, you can't do it in 1 year, obviously, but over 15, 20 year period would be a mixed-use development with housing and businesses and things like that. First of all, I think we need to think bolder. I think we need to think a using technology, and that's where broadband comes. We could have a tech center there. We could attract the kind of jobs that pay $25, $30, $50 an hour, real significant jobs where people are working in the information economy, tech jobs related to med tech, software development, all the kinds of jobs of the future in the 21st century. We have far too limited thinking when we just think about housing and retail. I mean, that's fine, except most retail is national retail. It's not homegrown, which means it's not living wage jobs. The overall impact on the community is not significant enough. So I'd like a tech hub as a possibility there so that we could attract tech companies, create significant jobs. The other thing is to look at the shops in St. Louis Park and at that type of entertainment complex, or for me, more appropriately, which I would love to see given the diversity of the Midway, is the Midtown Global Marketplace in Minneapolis looking to do something like that in St. Paul. Unfortunately, all we are hearing is about a stadium and a stadium task force and how do we make it work with tax giveaways, and that to me is a perfect analogy of where the city has misplaced priorities.
I think Tom might have misheard the question. I think the question was around what we're going to do with the land on Energy Park Drive where the old Midway Stadium was. So you'll get a chance to address it in the rebuttal, but obviously he wants to talk about stadiums, and I'm happy to talk about those too. But the land on Energy Park Drive was actually given by the city over to the Port Authority. The Port Authority is jointly developing it with a private developer. This is a new model that they created about 10 years ago. They've been kind of public-private partnership. The intention is to put about 200,000 square feet of light manufacturing, light industrial space, typical kind of Port Authority type project. Getting back to the jobs issue, and I agree with Tom to a point that we don't have a clear enough jobs goal in St. Paul, but the piece of the puzzle that has been very successful is the Port Authority turning blighted brownfields into job centers. The part of that is becoming a challenge is that we're running out of those large old industrial sites, and we're going to have to start thinking about creating jobs in smaller sites around town. Addressing briefly, because Tom brought it up, the stadium site, the part of the soccer stadium concept that appeals to me is the opportunity to actually bring in a lot of jobs around it. Not the stadium itself, although that will be some jobs, but the opportunity to turn not just the bus barn site, but that old shopping center into a much more job-dense and high-quality job-dense location. And I would not even support the concept if I didn't believe that that was possible. I think Tom's got a little bit outdated ideas about how you would do something like create a tech hub. The actual way that tech hubs get created is that you create the kinds of places where young tech employees want to be and want to work. And the employers end up locating in those places because their employees want to be there. You don't just sort of build something and they will come. It doesn't work that way.
Well, that's an interesting segue because I think Russ may have the outdated view. I don't know anybody that's moving to St. Paul for the view. They're moving there for a job. So it's not build it and you will come. Put a job there and they will come. Jobs are what attract people. Talk to young people and ask them where they want to live. They don't want to live someplace where there aren't jobs. No matter how many breweries and cool things there are, if they can't afford to live there, they're not going to live there. I'm sorry that I misunderstood the question. I will point out that We have a $3 million cleanup that the city's paying for at the old Midway Stadium site, something that the Port Authority conveniently didn't disclose to the City Council until the stadium deal was basically done. One of the partners in this deal is the Polad companies through United Properties, which also happens to be part of the ownership group of the soccer stadium that's being proposed for the Midway. And because I live in the Midway, I'm sensitive to that issue. I realize that stadiums is something I've worked on, but it's because I live in the Midway. So what happens at the Midway, at the old Midway Stadium site, may be interesting, but the Port Authority's failure to disclose that to me is a problem.
Now, here's just a quickie for either one of you. Are there any TIF properties in St. Anthony Park? Either one.
Yes, there are. In South St. Anthony, at least, I'm aware of just recently, in fact, under construction right now, the 2700 University project, which is being built at University and Emerald, which will be a 240-unit apartment building with some commercial space on the corner. And the reason why we agreed to use TIF on that project was because I personally insisted that if they were going to build housing on that corner, that it includes some affordable units. So 20% of the units will be affordable to folks earning 50% or less of the area median income. And that's exactly what the TIF is targeted toward, creating the affordability component of that project. Because I really value the idea that instead of just allowing market rate development to flourish along University Avenue, which we would like to see, that we make sure that we're actually building that mixed income, mixed use community.
That would be the only one. Okay, we'll move on.
There are a couple of others that just occurred to me. You can read from the list too. Emerald Gardens and 808 Berry Place, the housing right nearby there, were also part of a TIF district. Those deals predated my time on the council.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, I don't know what the category of a quickie question is. Is that we're are
well,
we
just not, have,
has
not
it been
timed, named?
Okay,
named
has it have people location. Satisfied that they got that answered? That if we could talk about TIF, but if people just want to know if there's TIF in St. Anthony Park, I'm willing to leave it there.
I think the questioner can catch you afterwards for a little more detail. Next one begins with Mr. Stark. And there's a couple questions here on potholes and sidewalks. It's kind of a public works thing, and as a fellow bicyclist, how concerned are you about the number of potholes and cracks in St. Paul's streets? And there's another one here somewhere about sidewalks too.
Okay, I am quite concerned about the condition of our streets, and actually I biked up here tonight as I was thinking about coming here and riding up Snelling Avenue across the bridge, because frankly there's no other way to get here from the Midway. I was thinking how critical it is that we make conditions safer out there for people who are biking around our community and walking. You all may recall that two winters ago we had the polar vortex, and our streets that spring were probably as bad as we've ever seen them. We got that message loud and clear. I know I did. And the council insisted on a major infusion into our arterial streets. The pothole issue is a tricky one in that we were spending so much money filling potholes that winter that we were actually losing money, because regular maintenance of the streets over time would actually be more affordable. A big part of that problem, honestly, and I'm not passing the buck, but a big part of that problem, a lot of our arterial streets are county roads. And for many years, the county focused on the arterial streets in the rest of the county and not on St. Paul, even though we're more than half of the county. And so we've been having a lot of conversations with our friends at the county about making sure that those resources are being spent more equally and that we're getting our fair share in St. Paul. We have made a lot of progress on the arterials, the terrible 20 that the mayor's talked about. As a cyclist, as a motorist, as a pedestrian, I think we all care about the condition of those streets out there. It's one of those really fundamental things about our city. When the mayor came to the council last year and said, what are your funding priorities in terms of anything we could do in terms of capital investment in the city, as a council we stood together and said, we have to invest in the streets. We also have to do it in a way that benefits people who are walking and biking, and that's where the 880 Vitality Initiative came from.
So when I'm out door knocking, and we've knocked on about 5,500 doors since I started campaigning in the beginning of July, what I say to people is that I don't think it should take a huge public outcry to fix the streets, that we should be able to do that proactively on a regular basis. Yeah, there was a polar vortex, and we had a lot of serious, you know, exacerbated conditions because of that, but the biggest issue is because the streets were already in horrible shape before that came along. And I can tell you that, you know, my dealings with the city, when I called about a street that was particularly problematic and called Public Works, I basically had a guy who told me that it wasn't on their agenda to fix, and that basically I could, you know, do whatever I wanted. He didn't really care. And then ultimately he referred me to the city council office. This happened to be a stretch of Hamlin, which Russ says is a county road. It's a stretch of Hamlin by Target that was literally like a war zone. I mean, it was so incredibly bumpy that if you're really trying to serve people, you would have said, we need to solve that problem right now. What I heard was, well, that's not in Ward 4, that's in Ward 1, so it's the Ward 1 council member's problem, and then got nowhere, and then eventually the amount of shrieking got so loud that they came out, and in about a day they fixed it. They scraped off all the tar they'd been putting down for years and years instead of rebuilding the road and put a nice, smooth service, and now we don't have a problem there for the moment. But it's interesting. The council did finally once speak out against the mayor, and they appropriated $42 million in funding to deal with some of the biking and other, and that they let the mayor take an $8 million haircut from that money and put it into renovating the Palace Theater. So even when it comes to roads, we're making trades with the mayor instead of insisting that money is all going to go towards our roads. So I think there's just a lot of, unfortunately, there's a lot of excuses, there's a lot of shifting. There's never a, we have a problem that we're not dealing with, and here's how we're gonna address it. And that to me is what's missing right now in the council and in the mayor's office.
I think in the course of his 2 minutes, Tom both congratulated me for taking a stand on roads and then said that I'm making excuses and not doing anything, so I'm not quite following. One of the important things to understand is that many years ago, when the city started rebuilding residential streets, and you probably have seen some of those in your neighborhoods over time, where we come in and literally dig up everything right down to the underlying sewers and infrastructure, that program sort of became a point of emphasis because, again, most of those arterials are county roads. We were focused on rebuilding our residentials. In order to actually put some more resources into those arterials, in the last couple of years, we've had to slow down our investments in the residential streets. There weren't a lot of other options. We actually are increasing the funding going into streets overall, but we've had to do some shifting as well because the priority became those arterial streets, and it was clear, and we all acted on it, and to the point, oh, my time's up.
Okay, are we ready? I think we're gonna have this be the last question. We've got more questions than time. And I'll put two of them together on serving on the council. Consensus is crucial to get ordinances passed and the council. A name and experience where you built consensus to get things done. And this other one is, if a council member proposes a change, should that individual be present for voting on the proposed issues? Anyway, serving on the council. And let's see, Mr. Goldstein. Yes.
I'm not sure which question to answer, but as far as consensus, I think we built consensus on broadband. We went around to caucuses. We got people to show up, support a broadband initiative. We brought the initiative to the city council. It passed with the most votes, became part of the DFL platform, and then the city did nothing with it. So you can build consensus, but if you don't have the right people there that are willing to take action, that's always going to be problematic. I think the council has remarkable consensus right now. It's almost 7-0 votes for most of the matters that come before the city, but I don't think that we're really doing innovative, terribly creative, or visionary things. I know that that's hard for people to hear because there are many people like me who really love St. Paul and you want to believe that your city is doing excellent work and you don't want to hear some of the inconvenient truths that are there. But I, for those who got the sheet and those who don't have it, I can give it to you when you leave. There's just a whole series of things that I won't go into, but some of them should catch your attention. One is our health department was taken over by the state inspection department. I mean, taken over. The problems were so egregious that the state had to step in and take it over. And if you read what Ed Ellinger said from the state, you would think that there were pretty significant problems. We had a park collapse in Lilydale where 2 kids died. And the city just said, you know, we're sorry, but we didn't know it was a problem. There's very serious issues we're confronting as a city. And so I don't think the question we need to be asking is about building consensus. It's about what can we do to make the city more accountable, solve problems, not have excuses, not give us explanations for why we're not doing what we need to do, but actually put a vision out there for where we're going to be and how we're going to make this city really live up to this slogan we have, the most livable city in America. That's the kind of campaign that I'm trying to run, and that's what I'm working for.
You don't necessarily have to create consensus on the council to move a matter forward. You do have to get to at least 4 votes, sometimes 5, depending on the issue. Bobby Meegard's over here saying, "Yeah, you got to count to 4." As council president this year, it's been an interesting process of trying to be that person who is trying to figure out, as a council, what are our collective goals. Where are our points of agreement and disagreement, and how can we work with the mayor and the administration to further those goals? There is a lot of work to figure out how to collaborate. We do have a strong mayor system in St. Paul. The council has a strong role as well. But to Tom's earlier point about the mayor and the Palace Theater Project as part of the 880 Vitality Fund, you do have to work with people who have different priorities than you do and still get things done. And sometimes that means doing this and this. You can't always just sort of pound your fist and say no. You're not going to get anywhere. You're not going to get anything done. Even though in St. Paul we are all DFLers on the council at this point, we have very different perspectives, very different priorities in terms of where we think resources should be going. And there's not a lot of resources, for the most part, that are in question. Most of our resources in the city are going to the day-to-day stuff, police department, fire department, that everyone values and that doesn't change very much from year to year. So we're really talking about working around the edges when you have rare opportunities to make investments because some debt got paid off or some federal money was available. For the most part, in my time on the council, one of the biggest issues has been the recession. And coming out of the recession, our departments got leaner and leaner and leaner to the point where, frankly, in the case of DSI, they were taken over by the state. Tom talks a lot about the fact that we talk about not having any money and build stadiums. There's a really huge disconnect between what's actually in the paper most of the time and most of the real work going on in city.
So before we start, I'd like to ask, is there a reason why we're ending early? Because
the library is going to close.
So I thought they closed at 8.
They do. But we have to be out of here before that and pack up and
okay, because I thought we were going to go to 7:30 for the debate and take more questions.
By the time we wrap it up, it'll be.
So I'm not sure how to answer it other than to say that getting to consensus, what are we getting to consensus about? If you look at St. Paul, name a company, a significant company or business that has come to St. Paul that has brought a significant number of jobs in the last 5 years. What we're doing is building buildings. This is developers' paradise. We are enriching developers. We are enriching, like Bernie Sanders says, millionaires and billionaires. People want a project. They come to the city. We have TIF funding that, contrary to what Russ is saying, we're giving away pretty liberally. The money that the issue with the health department and others is an issue of management. If you have a money problem, that doesn't keep you from mismanaging. You talk about what you need and make sure people are aware. There's a whole sheet here that shows this is not about money, it's about mismanagement. And until we acknowledge that we have problems, we're not going to solve the problems. And if we don't do that, we're not going to move forward. I'm sorry, that's the inconvenient truth that we need to deal with.
I'm going to read some of the topics that we don't have time for tonight, just so that you in the audience will know that your concerns are expressed and the candidates can hear what they are. There's one on block captains, conversion of single-family homes to rental property, protecting against mass shootings in the schools like in Oregon, climate change, an archery range in the city for instead of backyard shooting arrows, Grand Avenue parking, cost of street maintenance, partnering with the university, school start times, trash hauling, equity, African American, high poverty level and unemployment, and immigrants. There's a lot of issues out there, and our future city councilmen will have to deal with all of them. Mr. Stark, you were the first person to begin the opening statement, so the closing statements will be Mr. Goldstein.
Thanks, everybody, for coming. I'm going to steal a line from Robert Redford from the movie The Candidate and say, I want to talk about the things that we didn't talk about tonight. I want to talk about how we're going to attract cutting-edge businesses to St. Paul. I want to talk about how we're going to leverage our city resources to maximize educational outcomes for children. I want to talk about how we're going to have tax policies that do not unduly burden homeowners or small business. I want to talk about how we're going to make broadband a reality in the city that everyone can benefit from, and how we're going to do simple things like adopt a strategy that when you have the streets open, that you put conduit in the ground, which costs pennies compared to the tens of thousands you'll spend if you have to put it in later after the ground's already closed up. I want to talk about how we're going to reform our zoning code so that neighborhoods are adequately protected against senseless teardowns and the growing phenomenon of McMansion, something that the city is not adequately addressing. I want to talk about how we're going to reform TIF and have complete transparency so we can all see the kind of money we're putting into TIF and the kind of expenditures we have in the city that aren't going to benefit residents. I want to talk about how we're going to look at environmental measures such as banning plastic shopping bags, doing away with styrofoam, preventing runoff into our lakes. I want to talk about auditing our city departments and using the power of the city council to conduct investigations so that we have another voice in the city besides just the mayor's agenda, which Mr. Stark has clearly hitched his wagon to because the mayor just did a fundraiser for him a couple of weeks ago. And I want to talk about our urban tree canopy and about trimming our trees on a regular basis, because that's an environmental thing that is very important to us sustaining our neighborhoods. And I want to talk about a citywide scorecard that measures how we're doing on several key indicators so that we know how we're doing. And lastly, I want to talk about plowing our alleys. We should have alley plowing in St. Paul. It's sort of the poster child of things of we can't do as a city, even though we have all these other excuses that we can do. Thank you.
Thanks again for coming out tonight. It's great to have this opportunity. Congratulate Tom on a good debate tonight. It's a second one that we've had, and they've been really, I think, substantive conversations. A couple of things, similar to Tom, I want to focus on the things that I want to focus on in a third term. We have to continue to invest in infrastructure in the city that's going to allow people to move around our community more safely. We have to continue to invest in transit in other parts of the city beyond the Green Line. We've got to make our city safer for biking and walking. One of our huge competitive advantages is that we are urban and people want to be here and they want to be able to walk and bike around our community safely. We've got a lot of work to do. We have to improve our solid waste systems. I believe we should move to organized trash collection in the city of St. Paul. We're one of the biggest cities in the country that doesn't have it. It's ridiculous. We spend far too much money on our trash collection. Our alleys are paying the price. Our streets are paying the price. Our air is paying the price. We have to focus more attention than we have been on the issue of equity and racial disparities. And those are the three biggies for me. Tom has brought a lot of good ideas to the table with that list. One of the pieces of advice that I got coming into office 8 years ago, and if Tom wins this election, it'll be my advice to him as well, and that is the city is a big organization. It's a big ship. You're not going to be able to change as much of it as you want to. Think about changing 3% and choose that 3% carefully. I've done that by focusing on sustainability, transportation, and transit issues. My intention is to shift a little bit of that focus more toward the equity and racial disparity issues in a third term, because I think that is now the biggest challenge facing our city. I look forward to having the opportunity to do that, or to having Tom being our new council member and giving him some good advice about how we can all do that together. So thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, candidates and audience, for coming out. I think that the candidates will stay around for a little chat before the library closes us down. If any of you wouldn't mind, I think it would help the library if we stack the chairs. Thank you very much, and good night.
Thanks, Sylvia.